This example demonstrates the type of behavior that we can see in a continuous stir tank reactor where there's heat exchange. We have three solutions to the steady state equations. So I've already presented the Athena code, and let me just indicate some of the information, and then I'll show you some solutions. So first, these are our starting conditions in the reactor, initial concentration and temperature, and we'll be changing those. What I've listed over here are the three solutions. The steady state where there's not much conversion, so the lower steady state is a low temperature and most, you know, large fraction A remains. The middle steady state where there is conversion, the temperature's around 600. And then the upper steady state where we've converted 90% or so what's coming in, the feed is 0.5. And of course, we're at the higher temperature. The initial conditions, as I mentioned, are just the CA0 and the T0. And then if we look at the model equations, they're very similar to what we've looked at before with one exception. So we have a rate constant. And let me first just point out, we've written in terms of expression for heat generated, the heat of reaction, rate of reaction, volume, and expression for heat removal, where we have to heat up the feed coming in, and we also have heat exchange with some external temperature TJ. The first equation then is the mass balance, and the second equation is the energy balance written in terms of QG and QR. And rho CP, of course, is density times heat capacity, and then 48 is the volume. And so the temperature of the coolant or heating, depending on the conditions, but the external temperature that provides heat transfer has a dependence on the reactor temperature. And this says if the reactor temperature is higher, then indeed the external temperature is higher. And there's just some parameter that we calculated that is used to get this temperature, and we don't have to concern ourselves with the details there. It's just an expression that's a reasonable relation between the coolant or the heat transfer temperature. So first, let's look at the effect of the initial condition. So I've put in the starting point as the middle steady state. If I now ask it to solve, let me just indicate that just in terms of Athena, just pure differential equations, integrating up to time of 9, and CA and temperature are the two variables, and I checked to use the variables names in the calculations so that it will don't have to type in U1. It's easier to see where the equations come from. If I now ask it to solve, then I graph the results. So let's look at concentration versus time. So what you'll notice is that we started at the middle steady state, and indeed it looked like it was relatively stable for an hour or so. There's essentially no change. Enough decimal places there was change because it's drifting off of the steady state value, but it looks pretty stable. And then it drifts to the high concentration reactor and a low conversion, so what we call the lower steady state. And of course, the temperature shows corresponding behavior of appearing to be constant and then drifting to the lower temperature, corresponding to the lower temperature. Now it's at the lower steady state and it's stable. So that middle steady state does not drift dramatically. It's not a rapid change. And so you can imagine, and it's certainly possible, that we could sit at the middle steady state and use some sort of controller to keep us at the middle steady state. Okay, so now I've changed our starting conditions. Instead of starting at the middle steady state, let's start at the high conversion, the upper steady state. So I put in the initial temperature as the steady state value and the initial concentration. I'll save it and tell it to run and then look at the graph. So now I'll notice very different behavior. Let's make it a little easier to say. This is the concentration. We started at the steady state, but notice that it drifted away from the steady state. So it oscillated, and then the oscillations grew sufficiently large. It's not clear we're at a steady state yet. The temperature correspondingly also oscillated, and then the oscillations became larger. Looks like we're almost at a steady state. If I go up to the x-axis and make that, say, concentration, plot that temperature, then we see this unusual behavior, which is a little difficult to see here. So let me shorten the time and then show you the results. Okay, so same calculation. When I say shorten the time, what I've done is shorten the integration time so the axes are such you can see more of the details. So we started at the upper steady state, the high conversion. And what happens? Starting at that value, but you notice it drifts away, so it oscillates. So what we're looking at, we're plotting temperature versus CA. And notice that the temperature and the concentration start drifting away. We actually go through this, if you like, circle. We oscillate to bigger value, and then we drift far enough away, we drift towards the lower steady state. If I were to look at temperature versus time, then we can see these oscillations, and indeed we could look at both of them with two axes. And so the red now is the temperature, and the scale is such you can't see the oscillations as easy, and the blue is the concentration. But certainly we can see the oscillations in temperature here. So if we run it to longer times, we'll see the approach to steady state. So this shows the oscillations, and when I say longer time now, running out to time of 15. We see the oscillations in temperature, still some oscillation, and then we reach the steady state value of the concentration, similar type of behavior. So if we look at what we would refer to as the phase plane plot, so CA versus temperature, so now time is the variable along this line. We start with the high temperature around 650. We oscillate around that, and then we approach a steady state, constant temperature and concentration. And we know this is a steady state value based on looking at the individual plots of concentration and temperature versus time. So we can also use the ability of Athena to run a number of conditions in the same calculation. So we can go to the sensitivity analysis. So what I'm going to do is, with respect to model parameter, and the model parameter that I'm going to use is the initial concentration in the reactor CA0. And I'll run it from value of 0.5 to a final value of 0.05, and let's do four values. So now we're varying the value of CA0 that we put in the calculation. So this, when we click apply, this overrides what I've written here in the parameters, and we'll keep a constant temperature of T0. So we run this, and again look at the graph. So here's the phase plane plot for six starting conditions. And let me explain what we're doing. So the starting temperature, remember, is 600, and we varied the concentration over a range from 0.05 to 0.5. So if we start at 0.05, Notice that the temperature drops to our steady state value. So this is our lower steady state. This corresponds to Ca of 0.474 and temperature of 537. And as we raise the concentration in the reactor, keeping the temperature constant, we see the same behavior. It drops down until we cross some thresholds. So somewhere between 0.25 and 0.32, behavior changes. So now we start at this temperature, but this concentration, the rate is high enough that what we see is a very rapid or very large, it's also reasonably rapid, large temperature change. So the green line goes up to 780 degrees, almost no concentration reactor, so then the rate drops and we reach the same steady state. Well, the red line, the blue line show the same behavior, they just go to higher temperatures. So notice the difference. We start at 600, we overshoot up to 950 before settling back to 537. So there's some concentration in this region where a break point as to whether it's going to have a rapid temperature. So again, another example of this idea of parametric sensitivity, a slight change in our initial concentration reactor can make a large difference. So we could look at this range and repeat this calculation. So here's the same plot, and notice the differences now. So now we're ranging from the low value 0.23 up to 0.32 as our starting concentrations. And so when we start at 0.23 or 0.242, we drop to the lower steady state. Between 0.242 and 0.255, there's a really dramatic difference. So a very slight change now in the initial concentration, all at the same temperature, and look how dramatically different behavior is now. Instead of the temperature dropping from 600, it dramatically overshoots to 750 and then settles back. And then each of these other curves, of course, show the same behavior of overshooting, but notice they actually they cross each other. They show rather different behaviors, and the number of data points picked may affect the details of what these look like. But this, if I put the symbols in, there's only a couple data points in those rapid changes, so I could put in more points to show more details of those lines. So just to show the sensitivity, there's two graphs here. The red one is 0.244 as our starting concentration, and the blue is 0.246. The red line at 0.244 goes to lower steady state smoothly by the temperature decreasing. The starting condition of 0.246 goes to a dramatically higher temperature before going to this lower steady state. And finally, the same kind of calculation, but now the starting temperature is 650 instead of 600, and a range of concentrations from 0.02 up to 0.45. So the higher concentrations, again, we see this behavior overshoot to higher temperature and then approach to this lower steady state. If we start with less Ca in the reactor, the temperature increases less until we get to this point. So notice for the green line, which is the lowest concentration, this is the concentration of 0.02. If we just graph that, notice that it just shows a smooth change, whereas 0.91 overshoots. And of course, the higher concentration shows a rather dramatic overshoot before approaching the steady state.